If you'll take your hymnals, turn to number 551. 551, and please stand.
Thank you.
next one is on the screen.
As you see that I'm not Pastor Mike today, but I'll be filling in for him. I hope he's enjoying his time on his vacation. So just keep him and his family in prayer as they enjoy that time, and so that he can have a good time and time away. So we're all needed of that. And but what a beautiful day that we have that we can serve God today in his house, right? Amen to that. I praise God that we can come here, that we can serve him, and we don't have to go into hiding quite yet on our belief. But as Christians, we need to be the light of the world. That's what we are commanded to do, to go out into the world, to share the gospel, the good news with those people around us in this dark world. We shouldn't hide back. We should be a force out in this world that we're living in, and be constant in prayer for our nation as it desperately needs the hand of God to be back upon it and to guide and direct us in his ways if we ever want this nation to be great again. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Father, we come to you today. It's so good to be in your house, Lord, that we can serve you today and each and every day. Father, we lift your name on high. We pray that you be glorified through the service today and everything that is said and done, even through our own lives as we go through this next week. Help us to be prepared. Help us to put on the full armor of God that you call us to do each and every day. Be prepared to be that witness in this dark world. Father, I ask that you'd help us to prepare our hearts for your message. Father, I ask that you speak your truth and power through me. This is your message, not mine. I just want you to be glorified through what is said and done, Lord. Father, I ask that you please be with our nation as it desperately needs you. But we need to be obedient to what you're calling us to do. And to do our part within this nation that you've given to us. Father, again, just ask that you be with those that are hurting and struggling for whatever reason that may be. We think of Natalie and Kim as they are on the mend. Just ask that you keep healing their bodies, Lord. And we know that there's many more needs out there, Lord. I ask that you'd be with them. Comfort them in their time of need. If there's an opportunity to share the gospel with them, I pray that we would be obedient and do so. Because that's the only life-changing decision that they'll ever make. That's the most important question that they can ever answer. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus to them? Is he Lord or is he not? Father, again, thank you for this time that we can be gathered here. I ask that you be with our missionaries around the world as they proclaim the gospel, that they're being witnesses for you. I just ask that you'd ignite this nation again for you. Fill this congregation with the Holy Spirit today. Keep the evil one away as he'd like to distract and destroy what is going to go on today. And we give you all the praise and glory, and we ask all these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. You may be seated. A few announcements that I'd like to bring forward at this time. Of course, you can read some of those things there, but with the church picnic will be July 30th, and that'll be after the service on Sunday. Also, the baptism will be in August. We're not quite sure of the day yet, but the baptism will be in August. Also in August will be putt-putt. Everybody loves to putt-putt, right? It's always a good time, and of course, you can't just go and putt-putt, right? Tom, you got to go and get ice cream, right? It's gotta happen. Those things go together like spaghetti and meatballs, all right? So it's a necessity. It's got to happen. So if you would like to enjoy that, I believe it's on a Friday. I think it's usually on a Friday, if that's the 11th there. Then Harrison Lake service on the 27th of August. But also, what I want to bring to your attention is that we got VBS coming up the week of the 17th. Be in prayer on that. And if you'd like to help out with that, find someone that is involved with that and get involved with it. It's a great outreach for our community, for our church, for the kids, and just be involved with that. That's a great, great thing. So be in prayer on that, and just remember, if you'd like to be involved with that, do so and find someone to say, hey, I'd like to be involved with this. Also, one other thing I'd like to keep at the forefront of our mind is that communion's coming up. And I think it's always important, I believe it's always important that we prepare ourselves for communion. Communion is a very special and sacred thing. And we need to reflect upon our lives as Christians. This is the time we do this before we take communion, okay? Just remember that. If there's anything within our lives, any sin that's in our lives that we haven't given to Christ, that we're holding on to, lay it at his feet before we do so in communion. So be in prayer on that. Be looking forward to communion and what it coming up. So keep that at the forefront of your mind. Is there any other, and you can read through there, there's many other things that are coming up. Be aware of these things. But is there any other announcements at this time? Yep, Judy?
We are planning on doing the Eden Days Parade August 12th, I think it is.
It's not in the bulletin. I will come up with some details.
Okay. Anything else? Yep.
I'd like to thank everybody for the prayers. I got my new hip, and I just started again. Doing real well.
Okay. You're probably ready to kick field goals again, aren't you, Ed, huh? Well, good. I'm glad to hear that. So, anything else? Anything else at all? Did you want to give an update on Natalie or anything? Or?
Yeah. Yep. I'll just say that Natalie is doing really well.
She's having some pain here and there when they get her up to walk and stuff, but that's not unusual. But the doctors are thrilled with how well the kidney is functioning in her body. So praise the Lord.
Praise God for that. Keep all these prayer requests in mind, and of course, there's usually a slip on the back table there for more prayer requests. If you'd like to pick those up and pray over those things, please do so. So, anything else at this time? Any birthdays? Birthday. Appreciate it. Happy birthday to Cindy and Dwayne Higgenbotham. And is there any anniversaries today? All right. Cindy, Dwayne, I got to ask because I just kind of find it a little odd, I guess, if you will. Not in a bad way, but born on the same day?
Mine's the 29th of June. Wayne's the 5th of July.
Okay.
6 days apart. And we sat here last week. Pastor said it so fast we had kids that are laughing like, oh, went by us. Okay.
Yeah, that's all right. That's okay. Very neat. I'm like, well, I guess they're coming up for the birthday, but happy birthday anyway. So, all right. Okay. All right. Yes, at this time we had the watermelon feast video. So.
Is for the wind. adore, and love is all that I can give to you. Love is more than just a game for two. Two in love can't make it. Take my heart and please don't break it. Love was made for me and you. Love was made for me and you.
Take your hymnals one more time, please, and turn to number 394, and please stand. 394.
Jesus, keep me.
may be seated, and at this time, Cindy Higgenbotham and grandchildren have a special.
Anybody here, but can you see this little one right here? So I have a couple stories. First, I'd like to introduce to you who's up here with me today. This is Lily, she's 3. This is Quinley, she's 5. And this is Rayleigh, she's almost 7. So they're sisters. We have a daughter named Ellie, and these are 3 of her 6. Liam is back there, brother is back there. So there's 2 at home, and they're going to camp this week, so they couldn't be with us. The story I have to tell is about Lily, and a couple weeks ago they were on vacation, and they decided to go horseback riding. And Mommy had her on the horse with her, but it was a great big tall white horse. And on the path, on the walking path, you know, the trail for the horses, they came to a very steep ledge. And all of a sudden, Ellie heard Lily singing. And it was the chorus to this song that we're going to share this morning. The song is called Thank God I Do. And this is the verse, I want you to hear this. It says, I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. And her mommy's like, you know, she's trying to, what? Oh, and then she started singing with Lily. They all knew the song. And so I just thought it was real appropriate. You know, if a child at 3 years old can realize when they need to cry out to God, when they know they're in danger or they're afraid, the faith of a child, it just touched my heart so much that a child would think of that all on her own. And so I have a scripture out of Joel. It's chapter 2, verse 32, and it says, and it will come about that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered. I also want to share another, and it has to do with another verse of this song. I heard Lauren Daigle sing this song, and at first the words didn't really relate. I just couldn't get into it too much, but I love the tune. And then I started thinking, today is the anniversary of my father's unexpected death 7 years ago, exactly today. And I remember that year was very difficult for me. I was left with everything to do, all his accounts, everything was, nothing was. And it was a very difficult year. Dwayne was still up north working and living up there. I was down by these guys, but I was pretty much alone. And so part of the verse is, it's been a hard year, so many nights and tears, all of the darkness trying to fight my fears, alone, so long alone. And you know, I was thinking about that, and it's not always fun to think about things that were difficult, but the truth is, that's not going to be the last one. And so this song, as simple as it is, it just reminded me that, you know, thank God I do know Jesus. Thank God little Lily knows to cry out when she's feeling a little afraid. And I know these girls do too. So they're going to help me sing this song now. And here we go. Pull back just a little bit. There we go. Thank you.
I've seen love walk away. So many questions. Will anybody stay? It's been a hard year. So many nights and tears. All of the darkness trying to fight my fears. Alone, so long, alone.
Here we go, girls.
I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. I don't know where I'd go if I'll ever let go. So keep me held in your hand.
You guys do too, so I appreciate that. Thank you very, very much for that. At this time, Junior Church is dismissed. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Lord, we come to you today. And again, we thank you for this time that we can have with you, that we can meet together in fellowship and worship together. Father, I pray that your name would be exalted and lifted on high today. Father, I pray that we would take this truth that you've given to us, your word, and apply it to our lives and live according to it. I pray that we would have a better understanding of when we read your word and when it talks about certain things, that we would have a better understanding because of your message today. I ask, Lord, that you would speak through me your truth and your power. This is your message. I know it's been a blessing so far to me. Father, I just pray for our hearts to be open and receptive to your word. Father, just above all, just be glorified through what is said. Father, again, thank you for all that you do. And I ask all these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. I believe this verse was used last week. If I'm right, I can't remember for sure, but John 15, 12 through 13 says, "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." Today, we're going to be looking at the truth on love. Something that God has laid on my heart for quite some time to preach on. But as I look at love and as I listen to what the world has to say about love, we're going to get into the biblical meaning of love, but I think it's important that we understand where the world sees love. What does the world look at love as? And I think we have a pretty good idea of what the world looks at love as, because we hear it often and probably don't hear the biblical meaning of love as much. So I'm not going to be surprised if we don't have a real good grasp of what love is biblically. Yes, I understand we see love portrayed in the Bible. But what I want to do is I want you to get the deeper meaning of why the Word of God uses love instead of the worldly meaning of love. So how does the world look at love? Well, we know that the world looks at love in a conditional way, in a selfish way, in a controlling way. And what I mean by this is when you look at things of this world, and if it doesn't satisfy me, if it's not meeting my needs or my wants, my selfish needs and selfish wants, then we just kind of throw it away, don't we? We just kind of throw it away. We're not committed to love in this world. We're not committed to love in this world. And if I can't have you do something for me, and if you're not willing to do something for me, then I don't want anything to do with you. It's kind of a throwing away look at love. I'll use it to please myself for a while, but then I'll get rid of you. Marriage isn't really marriage anymore. It's something that you do for a while and then that's it. You see, God hates divorce. And I understand there's a lot of facets that go within a marriage. Marriage is not always easy. It can be hard work. This love that the world looks at is a feeling, isn't it? If it feels good, do it. All right? If it feels good, do it. But listen, when we look at love in the world, the way the world looks at it, it's something that is so captivating to our feelings. It also is not just conditional. It's not only selfish. It's not only controlling. But it's a compromise, isn't it? You probably have heard the world say, well, God is love. And speaking from an outsider's perspective, not a believer in Jesus Christ, a non-believer, say, well, God is love. And they're right, God is love. And we'll go over that.
But they use it in such a wrong way so that we accept what they do. God is love, so he should love that I am homosexual. No, God loves you, and he hates the sin. We have to also remember that, yes, God is love, but see, this is the world's perspective of love. God is love, but he's also what? He's righteous, and he's just. So when we're trying to compromise the way we do things, and we're saying that God is love and he needs to love me the way I am, I say fooey to that. God does love you, but when we come to Christ, we are a new creation. This might help us to understand. We have an old nature and a new nature. What is the nature of the fish? Is it to jump from tree to tree? To live on land? No, the nature of the fish is to swim in the sea, right? That's what it naturally does. So the ungodly natural ability is to live in the world and do what the world does. But the believer in Jesus Christ gets a new nature and is different from the world. So our nature now is changed and we do what is pleasing to God. We do what is pleasing to God. You see, the world looks at love in a fleshly way. And that flesh is fueled by Satan. Look at what we watch on TV. And honestly, if you're watching, I don't watch much regular TV. And I've got just an antenna, so I get like three stations and that's about it. Which I'm okay with. Nothing wrong with that. But you can't even watch, let's just say, maybe a football game without having what? A commercial come on, and it's geared towards sex, if you will. It pleases our flesh. We look at those things, and it draws us in. Who's behind that? Satan's behind that stuff. He uses people to manipulate our flesh. Look at what people wear now. Look at what we listen to on the radio. Go to the park and listen to the vulgarity of the words that people use. We are to be different from the world and our natural, when we become Christians, our natural ability is to please God. So, we've got an idea of what the world looks at love as. But see, our even English definition of love doesn't compare to God's love either. Our English word for love has watered down everything that God has done. And it just lumps everything into, it takes a lot of things and puts it as love. I love pizza. Boy, I love my dress. I don't have a dress. I was just saying, ladies, maybe this is where you're at, all right? I shouldn't have said that because of the times that we're living in. I had to put that out there. Listen, maybe I love this car. You see, there's a lot of nice things out there, but this is nothing that the Word of God uses love for. But see, this is the English word for love. This is what the English word says that we, yes, we can put this in here and we can get love out there. I love my spouse. Well, if you look at the English word for love, you're saying, I love my car just as much as my spouse, or I love my dress just as much as my spouse. You see, there's a disconnect there. There's not enough meaning there when we look at the English word for love. But when we get into the Word of God, this is where it becomes different. I'm going to take you back to the Greek words that the Bible uses for love. And many of you probably have already know these, and that's great. But I think when you go and read the Word of God, you should have a better understanding of what it says when it means love. To be honest, when I hear the word love, I'm kind of turned off by it, because I know that it's not a great meaning like the Word of God has within His Word. So, as we go on here, I want you to keep in mind, as we read, we're going to look at a certain type of love, all right? There's four that we're going to go over. Actually, there's four that I'm going to tell you about, but I'm only going to go over one for the time being. We'll see where God leads us for next week, and maybe we'll continue this little mini-series on love and look at a different facet of love, but that's up to Him, all right? That's up to Him. I'm going to leave that up to Him. But we're going to look at one facet of love, and you're probably going to know this word for love, but I hope when you read God's Word, now that when you read love and come across that, that you're going to have a better understanding instead of a worldly understanding of what love is when we read the Word of God. Because most of the time when I read the Word of God, I think of the worldly or English version of love. Okay? So, what is love, and how does the Bible demonstrate this love? All right, so going to the Greek words of love, the first one we come across is, and I apologize if I don't get quite the pronunciation quite right. I apologize for that in advance. But the first one is eros, E-R-O-S, eros. This is a sensual or romantic love, okay? This is a sensual or romantic love. And there's many verses, but I'm not going to go over those today because I want to get to the one that we're going to deal with today. Number two, steraj. And it looks like storage to me, but that's not the way it's pronounced. It's S-T-O-R. A-G-E. And this is a family love. This is a natural bond between parents and children, like Noah and his wife, like Jacob for his sons, Mary and Martha for their brother Lazarus. When Vanessa and I first had our first child, and each and every one of them, but when we first had that first child, it just dawned on me how, when Trip came out, how much love right off the bat, naturally, that you had for that child. It was easy to love that child. You just saw, you saw him coming out, and you were just in awe and amazement for that child and that love that you had. Just naturally. And I think, honestly, all of us as parents have probably felt that. It's just an amazing feeling that you can feel that right off the bat. You know, some of us have been worn down by our spouse. You know, we date for a while. We ask the question, was it love at first sight? Some people say, oh, absolutely, yes. But some people, you know, they wore on me. But when you have your first child, when you have your children, it's just natural, just instinctively natural. So that's number two. Number three is philia. We get our word Philadelphia from here, okay? Brotherly love. But what this goes beyond what brothers would have a love for. It doesn't have to necessarily be two blood brothers, okay? But what the meaning of this love is, an emotional bond seen in deep fellowship or friendship. And the best thing that I can think of on this type of love is that the disciples showed this to each other. Of course, it's a strong bond, but soldiers show this for each other. People that had to rely heavily on each other and that are always around each other. Firemen, policemen, people that are in combat, we think of. Or people that are just, you can't separate them. There's just such a strong bond there, a brotherly love. And some of these loves, all right, if you will, can intermingle. You can have multiple loves within this one love. But the last one, and I want to hit most on this last one, okay? Number four is agape, all right? A-G-A-P-E, with a little squiggly over the E, whatever that thing is. So, it's agape. This is the highest of the four types of love. This is the highest of the four types of love. Agape is used over 200 times in the New Testament. So when we, like I said, we're talking about love here. When we read in the New Testament, most of the time when it talks about love, it's going to refer to agape love. Some, if you will, some, the King James refers to charity. Some other versions will refer to this is God's love, God love. But in some versions, all it says is love. Okay? But this is agape love. And most of the time when we come across it in the New Testament, it means this. Agape is perfect. It's unconditional. It's sacrificial. This love serves. It sacrifices. It's supernatural. This love comes from God. This love comes from God. This is a supernatural. This is supernatural love. Agape isn't born just out of emotions or feelings or familiarities or attractions, but from the will and is a choice. You choose to love this way. You choose to love agape. Agape love, and I'm going to quote this because I thought this was very good, but it says, agape love does not come naturally to us. Like I said, this love is given, all right? This is natural for God, but it's not natural for us. Agape love does not come naturally to us because our fallen nature. We are incorruptible of producing such a love. If we are to love as God loves, that love, agape, can only come from its source. Very important. It can only come from its source. This is the love that has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us when we become his children. Romans 5:5 says, And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God, agape of God, is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. When we become a believer in Jesus Christ, when Christ comes into our lives and we allow him to come into our lives and we choose Jesus, this is an attribute of God. God gives this to us. We can look at Galatians 5:22 and we know that this is one of the fruits of the Spirit that God gives to us, is agape love. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. 1 John 3:16, not John 3:16, but 1 John 3:16. Hereby perceived we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Because of God's love toward us, we are able to love one another. Listen, this love is so much different from what the world has to say. This love is given by God. So there's 3 points I want us to look at on agape. The first one is that this love is a noun. You're thinking, well, how can love be a noun? Because the word God tells me that it is. If we go back to 1 John 4, verse 8, it says, 4, verse 8, it says, he that loveth not known, knoweth not God, for God is love. For God is love. If we jump over to verse 16 in chapter 4 of 1 John, it says, and we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. You see, this is different from the world. Honestly, I honestly want you to think hard about this. Jesus died for our sins, didn't he? He died for each and every one of us. He's our payment, right? But he did he do that for just the so-called good people of the world? Did he do that just for the so-called elite of the world? Listen. What kind of love must you have to go willingly to the cross and choose death? Because that's what he did. He chose death. Listen, was Jesus perfect? Answer that question. First question we have to answer, was Jesus perfect? Did Jesus have to die? No. Jesus did not have to die. Why? Because he was perfect. The Bible, the Word of God, says that he chose to die. Now you think about that. Did he just choose to die for some people and let the others go to hell? No. He chose to die for the world. The whosoever. And he chose to die. And he gave his life. The most brutal death known to man. Oh, it wasn't just on the cross, but it was the flogging before that. You think Jesus knew what he got himself into? And he still chose that punishment, one, to please the Father, and two, so that we can have a relationship with the Father through Jesus, if we so choose. Now, what kind of love, getting back to my point, what kind of love does Jesus have to have? And they get the choice. We get the choice to choose Jesus, but still go to the cross for hardened criminals, for rapists, for people that want to destroy whole countries. And if they have the opportunity, they choose to come to Christ through that, or they choose not to, what kind of love must that look like? And we see it demonstrated through the scriptures. That is agape love. You see, my flesh doesn't want to die for the hardened criminal. My flesh doesn't want to die for people that do me wrong. That's my flesh. But my spirit tells me that they're on the road to death, and the only love that they can see or may see is through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ that I have. I can demonstrate the love of God towards those people if I choose to. Or we can put up our noses and say that you're not worth it. What kind of testimony is that? You see, this love is different from anything else. This love is special. It's supernatural. It goes on. It goes beyond our way of comprehension, even. But it's a beautiful, beautiful love. You can't ask for any better love than this. Because guess what? I guarantee when Jesus was on the cross and he was taking the punishment for that sin, I can't help but think that my name went across his mind. Your name went across his mind. I'm doing this because I love you. And I am choosing to give my life for you. See, the Father gave his one and only Son. To give your Son as a sacrifice for someone else is ultimate. Can you imagine allowing your Son to die so that someone else can live? That's unfathomable to me. No, I would want to save my own Son before I would save someone else's, right? That's not what God did. I will give my Son, and I will show you my ultimate mighty love for you, because I love you. You go out into that world the next time, and I hope as you go out into the world, I hope you reflect upon this love and how brilliant and beautiful this love is. So when you cross paths with someone else and God gives you a yearning to tell them about Christ, that you do it. As believers in Jesus Christ, that's what we ought to do. But going back, love is a noun. This is God. God is love. This is his deity. This is his nature. The second point. So love, this love is a noun. This love is also a verb. This love is also a verb. It is shown, it is demonstrated, it is put into action. I know you know this very well, but if we turn to Corinthians chapter 13, and we'll just read just a little bit of this. But this is agape love as we read this. Remember that. Remember agape love. And when I read this, it's going to use charity in this version compared to love, but it's the same thing, okay? So it says in verse 13, chapter or 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am becoming as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profits me nothing. And we could go on and on through that chapter there. When you do something out of love, do people realize that? But when you do something grudgingly for somebody, do people realize that? Most of the time it turns them off. Even though you committed the task for them and you do it in a grudging manner, do you think they're very appreciative of it? Most likely not. But when someone comes and says, I'll do that for you, let me take that, and you come alongside them and you show that love towards them, what happens? Fellowship starts to happen. A friendship can maybe evolve out of that. So when we do things out of love, it makes a big impression on the people that we're doing it for. 1 John 4, 9 through 10 says, in this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. You see, God loved us even when we didn't love him, and he chose to go to the cross for us on our behalf. What an amazing God. What an amazing God that we serve and have. Most of us would not do that. If someone hated us, we wouldn't willingly go to the cross and die for that person. But guess what? As believers in Jesus Christ, we have a new nature, don't we? That new nature says yes. And if we abide in God and he in us, he starts renewing that nature. And we become, and it comes to the point where people just don't understand that type of love. The reason they don't understand that type of love is because it comes from God. And they're out of fellowship with God, or they don't have a relationship with God. But it doesn't mean that they don't appreciate it. Maybe they don't understand that type of love, but they want that type of love. They need that type of love. Just like Jesus gave his life for us, because we needed that type of love. It is a God-given love. It is a God-given love. Romans 5:8. Romans 5:8 says, "But God commandeth this love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." I hope we can look at love in a whole different aspect than what we came to church today and looked. Maybe some of you already know this stuff, and that's great. But guess what? The world infiltrates us with the love of the world so very much that I think we tend to forget what God's love truly is and what it looks like and how it's demonstrated. Like I said, I've always had kind of a sour taste when people use the word love, but I know how it's being used. It's not sacrificial. It's not unconditional. It's only if people want, if it feels good and it meets my needs, that I want it. If it doesn't, then I don't want it. This love says, "I love you, and I'll do this for you." The last point I have, love is given. Love is given. This love is given. We can only receive this love through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Other people might see it. Non-believers might see this, but they don't understand it. And they can't get it unless if they have a relationship with Jesus Christ. 1 John 4:13-17 says, "Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us his Spirit, and we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed and loved that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because he, as he is, so are we in the world." Love is given to us through a relationship with Jesus Christ. We can only experience this love through him. But it doesn't mean that when you're a child of God and you get out of line that you're not going to be disciplined. A lot of people want to use love and say, "Well, I'm free to do what I want. I'm free to do what I want." You see, that's the way the world looks at it. But God, my Father in heaven, when I get out of line, he disciplines me. Why? Because he doesn't want me to go back to that. He doesn't do it out of hatred. He doesn't do it just because he wants to. There's a purpose behind the discipline of my Father in heaven. Just like my boys, if they go out and play in the busy street, you think that I'm not going to discipline them? Oh, you better believe it. Why? Because I sure don't want them going back out there again, taking the chance that I may never see them again. You see, I do it out of love, not out of hatred, not just because I want to do it. I don't want to do it, but I do it because it's necessary. I do it because I see that there's a danger there. Just like our Father in heaven will discipline us when we get out of line because he sees the danger there. Listen, as children of God, he loves each and every one of you. He's got a purpose for you. I know the world tells you that there is no purpose for our lives. I tell you that there is. Jesus died. He loves you. God gave his one and only son because he loves you. He agapes you. That word means so much more to love than what I've listened to coming from the world. There's deep meaning, and there's more meaning than I even brought to the table today. It's an amazing study. But I want you to know, the next time that you read God's word and you're going through the New Testament and you come across the word love, I sure hope you look at it in a deeper meaning than what normally we do. And if it's just me and you guys do understand that, that's great. I applaud you. That's wonderful. But if you're like me, and it gave you a bitter taste when you hear people use the word love, now I can look at it in a different way. I know what the Word of God says on love. And this type of love is supernatural. This type of love is unconditional. Our Father loves us so very much. He loves each and every one of his creation. You don't think he's pleading? Don't you think that God is out there wanting us to be obedient to his call and share the good news with those around us? Why? Because he longs for the relationship with us, with his creation. But the ultimate thing with love is that he allows us to choose love. And what that does is that makes it genuine. Our love for him is genuine when we choose to love him. We're not forced to love him. He still loves us, but we're not forced to love him. So, in closing, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I'm going to put this point blank. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you're out of the will of God. There's a place called hell. Like I said, I'm going to be point blank with you. And that's where eternity will be for you. But there's another way. You see, there's a punishment for sin. Either you can take that sin and you can take the punishment yourself, and that's where you'll end up, as in hell. Or, you've heard me say this name a lot today. Jesus paid that price. And when we put our trust in him, we can have eternal life through him. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. Today is the day of salvation. You can know without a doubt that you are saved by what Christ has done on your behalf. You become a new creation in him. He changes your nature. When Jesus comes in, the Holy Spirit comes into you, he will not live in filth. He will start cleaning you up. He will start convicting you of sins that are in your life. He will no longer give you that will to want to sin. But remember, we have a fleshly side to us. And that spiritual side and that fleshly side will hammer each other. Don't think by a minute that the spiritual side is weaker than the fleshly side. It's not. But if we choose to give in to the flesh and don't feed the spiritual side, if you will, if we're not getting into the Word of God, if we're not praying, if we're not coming to church, these are all things that help feed our spiritual side and our growth in Jesus Christ. If we're not doing those things, then our flesh becomes overtaking of that spirit. Not because the spirit is weaker, it's just because we keep feeding these desires and we keep longing for these. Listen, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, today is the day of salvation for you. You can know. He paid the price for us. He's given his life for us. That supernatural, beautiful love that he has given can be yours, and he can show you that love too. He loves us all very much. He loves us all very much. So as we end, I think it's 301 is the last hymn. And if you don't know Christ today as your Lord and Savior, you can come right up front. Come to the altar and give your life to Christ. You can do it right in your pew. Reach out to him and say, Lord, I know I'm out of the will, out of your will, Lord. But I pray that you would come into me. I accept what you've done on the cross on my behalf. Make me a new creation. Help me to repent from my sins. Allow me to make you Lord of my life. And maybe you're here today and you're just distant from God. And you've fallen out of fellowship with God. Maybe you need to come to the altar and lay down some sins that God is exposing in your life. You're welcome to do that also. Take the opportunity and do whatever God is calling you to do today. Whether in your pew or up here. If you'd like, someone can come up here and just pray with you. Maybe that's what you need. Just grab someone by the arm. Say, will you come up? Will you pray with me? Do whatever God's calling you to do today. But I want you to know that the love that God has for you is totally different from the way the world looks at love. It's special. It's beautiful. And it's abundant. It's never-ending. It is who God is. It's his nature. He is love. He demonstrates it through his Son. And it is given to us when we receive him as Lord and Savior, his Son. So as we stand, we sing 301, I believe it is. Reflect on what God has in your life.
Save us, Lord, for sinners such as us.
appreciate everybody coming today. We still have services tonight at 7 if you'd like to come. We'll be getting into the Word also, and we got the praise time. And listen, one other thing, as you go out into the world, reflect upon this love that God has. I hope you see His love differently than the world has for you today. And also, I just wanted to let you know, it's still just over 8:45. We didn't lose any time. That clock still says 8:45. I started at just over 8:45. We're still at just over 8:45. So time is on our side today, all right? But at that, Chris, would you dismiss us in prayer, please?
Thank you for the message that's been brought forth, and I pray that it will be applied in each one of our lives, Lord, and we can take and use it, and we can spread your word and spread your love throughout this world, Lord. We pray that we could bring more people to you that don't necessarily know you, or they may know you and just are not sure what to think, and just pray that we can guide each one in the right direction, Lord. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Mm-hmm.